Lord, the world looks different now. Work looks different. I once viewed labor as ordinary. Now it's many things I never dreamed it would be. Cherished. Important. Scary at times. As I step into my day, I think of work in a far different way. I pray for those who've lost their jobs. May what I do help them prosper. I know that whatever my work looks like, be it on the front lines or in the back room, be it at home with children or surrounded by coworkers, you are there with me. So I take this day to reflect, rest if I'm fortunate, to ponder and pray, so I can walk into this world renewed and ready. Amen.
Welcome to Worship with Messiah Online. We are glad you are with us today. This is the Labor Day weekend. So because of that, our monthly drive-through for the Caring Hands Food Pantry will be on Tuesday this week, not Monday as it usually is. It'll be from 9 to 11 a.m. on Tuesday, September 6th. Our Living Vine Women's Bible Study Group will begin this Thursday. They meet at 9:15. If you'd like to participate, you can still sign up online. Or if you're here on Sunday morning, you can sign up on the patio. Our adult forum will begin on Sunday, September 18th. That meets at 10 a.m. Jake Bach will be leading a series on religion in America, looking at the reformers, the revivalists, the radicals, and the rogues who are still shaping American Christianity. And then our Wednesday night studies will begin on September 14th. We'll have both an afternoon and an evening session. The evening session will be available both on Zoom and in person, and we'll be looking at fresh perspectives on Paul, what recent scholarship about first century Judaism helps us understand about Paul's writings. And I'm really looking forward to that. I'm hoping you'll join me for that. Now let's begin worship as we sing our gathering hymn.
Your freedom, awake and alive. Oh,
Let's pray. Guide and direct us, Lord, in all of our thoughts, our words, and our deeds. Send your Holy Spirit on us to inspire and strengthen us so that all of your works may begin, continue, and end in you, bringing glory to your holy name. By your mercy, redeem us from the consequences of our own failures and bring us to everlasting life in you. We pray this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior and our Lord. Amen.
All things bright and beautiful, all creatures great and small, all things wise and
Our scripture today is from Deuteronomy chapter 30, beginning at the 15th verse. Moses is speaking to the people. See, I set before you today life and prosperity, death and destruction. For I command you today to love the Lord your God, to walk in obedience to him, and to keep his commands, decrees, and laws. Then you will live and increase, and the Lord your God will bless you in the land you are entering to possess. But if your heart turns away and you are not obedient, and if you are drawn away to bow down to other gods and worship them, I declare to you this day that you will certainly be destroyed. You will not live long in the land you are crossing the Jordan to enter and possess. This day I call the heavens and the earth as witnesses against you, that I have set before you life and death, blessings and curses. Now choose life, so that you and your children may live, and that you may love the Lord your God, listen to his voice, and hold fast to him. For the Lord is your life, and he will give you many years in the land he swore to give to your fathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And that's the end of the reading. Now, sisters and brothers in Christ, grace and peace to you from God our Father, from our Lord and our Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. What would you rather have to eat? An ice cream cone or broccoli? Most of us, I suspect, would rather have an ice cream cone, at least if we got to pick what flavor of ice cream it was. President George H.W. Bush famously disliked broccoli. He was quoted as saying, "I do not like broccoli, and I haven't liked it since I was a little kid. And my mother made me eat it. And I'm president of the United States, and I'm not going to eat any more broccoli." Or would you rather have a Snickers bar or Brussels sprouts? I'd bet most of us would prefer a Snickers bar. Personally, I can't stand Brussels sprouts. As a kid, I didn't like them. I still don't. On the other hand, I know Brussels sprouts are trendy these days. Somebody told me I should try them with bacon. So I did. I was shocked to discover that it's possible to ruin bacon. Broccoli and Brussels sprouts are good for us. Ice cream and Snickers bars are bad for us, at least if we eat very much of them very often. After hearing Pastor Tim Ellington, our guest preacher last week, talk about drinking Diet Coke, I looked it up. Diet Coke is also bad for us, at least if we drink more than a couple cans a day. But I'll probably still drink Diet Coke. We don't always choose what's good for us. That was the problem that the people of Israel had, as reported in Deuteronomy chapter 30. They had a choice, and they didn't choose what was good for them. The book of Deuteronomy, literally the second law, is the second giving of the law by Moses as the people of Israel are preparing to enter the promised land of Israel. In a series of sermons, Moses repeats, summarizes, and reinterprets instructions found in the previous books, providing the people rules to follow, ethical directives, a code of moral and social behavior, and general advice about how to live. All of which is intended to govern their lives after they enter the promised land. And more importantly, intended to help them live in community as the people of God, to truly live the life God wanted for them. The most important thing was to worship only Yahweh, the God who would set them free from Egypt, and not to worship any other gods, including the local idols worshipped by the people who were already living in the land. Next was to follow the Lord's commands. And Moses gives them a choice: life and prosperity, or death and adversity. If they obey the Lord's commands, loving the Lord, walking in his ways, then they'll be blessed. They'll have life. But if they worship other gods, if they worship idols, if they don't obey the Lord's commands and hold fast to him, they'll get death and destruction. They'll get curses. And the judgment of the writers of the rest of the Old Testament was that they chose wrong. They worshiped idols. They didn't follow the Lord's commands. So they got adversity, death, and destruction. Curses instead of blessings. As the northern kingdom was conquered by the Assyrians, and Jerusalem was conquered by Babylon. Maybe you wouldn't see it coming if you read only this passage in Deuteronomy, if you didn't already know the rest of the story. But a similar passage in Joshua 24 makes it clear what's going to happen. Moses got the people to the promised land, ready to cross the Jordan River into what's now Israel. But Joshua is the one who actually took them in. By the end of the book of Joshua, they've entered and taken control over much of the land, although maybe they hadn't taken quite as much control as they thought. And Joshua, toward the end of the book, leads them in a ceremony to affirm their loyalty to the Lord, repeating much of the language we just read from Deuteronomy 30. In the line that may have been the inspiration for Bob Dylan's song, "You Got to Serve Somebody," Joshua challenges the people to serve the Lord, not other gods, not to worship other idols. "Choose this day whom you will serve," he says, "but as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord." When the people say, "Of course we'll serve the Lord," Joshua says, "No, you won't, and it won't turn out good for you." They reply, "Yes, we will." But unfortunately, the rest of the Old Testament proves Joshua right. The Old Testament contains 613 commandments. That's a lot. But they can be summarized in what Jesus calls the two greatest commandments: love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. Your relationship with God and your relationship with other people, especially those less well off than you are at the heart of Old Testament and Christian ethics. The judgment of the prophets is that over their history, the people of Israel failed to follow the commandments, particularly those related to worshiping only the true God and related to treatment of the poor. The prophet Hosea, for example, condemns the nation of Israel for idolatry, comparing Israel to an unfaithful wife or an ungrateful son. In Amos, on the other hand, the sin for which Israel is condemned is mistreatment of the poor. In Amos chapter 2, we read, "Thus says the Lord, for three transgressions of Israel and for four, I will not revoke the punishment, because they sell the righteous for silver and the needy for a pair of sandals. They who trample the poor into the dust of the earth and pushed the afflicted out of the way." Amos judges the people of Israel, particularly the wealthy and the powerful, for being more concerned about their own power and their own profit than about those who need help, those who don't have the resources to protect themselves. David French is a theologically conservative Presbyterian and an attorney. He's also a conservative commentator who writes a column called The French Press. A recent column suggested that we Americans, including American Christians, have our ethics upside down, or at least have our priorities wrong. And the problem has something to do with being arrogant, self-centered, and proud. French referred to Micah 6, verse 8, which happens to be one of his favorite passages and one of Pastor Bob's favorite passages, as providing what he believed to be a good summary of Old Testament and Christian ethics. Like many biblical passages, Micah 6, 8 seems simple to understand, but is probably tough for most of us to live out in practice. "He has told you, O man, what is good, and what does the Lord require of you but to do justice and to love kindness and to walk humbly with your God." It's hard enough to do two things at once. It might get even tougher with three: do justice, love kindness, walk humbly. Many of us think of justice as either bad people having to pay for their wickedness, their evil deeds, or in terms of whether I'm personally getting what I think I deserve. But the biblical view of justice is different. Pastor Tim Keller — apparently I'm quoting a lot of conservative Presbyterians today — has argued that biblical justice is characterized by radical generosity, universal equality, both collective and individual responsibility, and what he calls life-changing advocacy for the poor. The prophets concluded that the people of Israel, especially those with wealth and power, missed the boat in terms of caring for the poor. Kindness can be thought of fairly simply as how we treat other people. Author and philosopher Aldous Huxley, for example, has been quoted as saying, "The best advice I can give to people is to be a little kinder to each other. But the Hebrew word translated in this passage as kindness, or sometimes as mercy, is more complex. The Hebrew word is hesed, which doesn't really translate easily and directly into only one English word. It has to do with compassion, loyalty, faithfulness, and love. It is sometimes translated as steadfast love or unfailing love. When the Old Testament was translated into Greek, the translators used the word agape, or unconditional love, as a translation of the word we usually translate as kindness or mercy in this famous passage in Micah. So Micah 6:8 could literally be translated as telling us that we are to love love. And this famous Bible verse, with its admonition to love kindness, really has to do with what Jesus calls the second great commandment: love your neighbor as yourself. Walking humbly with God means being careful to put God first and to put others ahead of ourselves. Further, as French points out, the word humbly implies that we should have a sense of humility about how we live our lives, and for that matter, about the certainty of our own knowledge, how certain we are that we are correct. French argues that we often let kindness or mercy or love go by the wayside as soon as we have a disagreement about what constitutes justice in a particular situation, when we disagree about the solution to a particular problem. This can especially be true if we think about justice in terms of what's good or fair for me, if our self-centeredness and our pride gets in the way. And, French argues, we also tend to lose our sense of humility about our own knowledge when we have those kinds of disagreements. French got into this discussion of Micah 6:8 and how good a job we American Christians are doing at living our lives by God's standards because of a recent study by the Pew Research Center. The study found that a tremendous number of Americans are likely to think that people who disagree with them are one or more of the following: immoral, dishonest, unintelligent, or close-minded. And French concluded, based on this study, this means that we Americans, including American Christians, often forget about kindness, mercy, or love, and humility when we disagree with someone. Put another way, we forget about kindness, mercy, or love, and humility when what's at stake is our ability to enforce our will in a given situation. So what's at stake ultimately may be our own arrogance, our self-centeredness, our pride, and our own power. If we're able to dismiss other people's opinions because we think they're immoral or stupid, we don't actually have to consider them or reconsider our own opinions or behaviors. And then we also don't have to respect those people who disagree with us about something. This arrogant self-centeredness and pride keeps us from living out God's love for others, and maybe keeps us from following the Lord. Our perceived self-interest, about which we might be wrong, triumphs over love and humility. And, French argues, the result is that as a nation, we are tearing ourselves apart. What do we make of all this? Choosing life, prosperity, abundance, and blessings sounds easy. It sounds like a no-brainer. But unfortunately, it's not. Sometimes it's hard because we discount the future. We choose immediate gratification. In the long term, most of us know that broccoli or Brussels sprouts are better for us than ice cream or a Snickers bar. But that's long term. and we want the ice cream or a candy bar now. That's why I still drink Diet Coke. I want it now. At various times, the people of Israel knew they were making the wrong choice. They knew they were in trouble. But the consequences would be long-term, not immediate. Sometimes we make the wrong choice, not choosing what is life-giving because we don't have enough information. We need to have some humility about our own knowledge and recognize that sometimes we'll make mistakes. Sometimes we'll be wrong because we don't have the right perspective, the right information. My friend Sam sometimes said that he didn't actually make mistakes. He just didn't always have enough information to make the right decision. Sometimes we fail to choose life because of fear. We do things we shouldn't do as a way of coping with fear or anxiety, like the people of Israel worshiping other local gods, idols, as a way of hedging their bets. Today, we're more tempted to make a god with a small g out of money or the stuff it can buy, or something else that we think can provide us with security. But sometimes we simply fail to choose life out of self-centeredness, arrogance, or pride. We choose what turns out to be adversity, death, and destruction. We do this because our pride and our selfishness, perhaps the original sin, get in the way of loving the Lord or loving our neighbors. Keeps us from doing justice, loving mercy, walking humbly with God. And that's what happened to the people of Israel. Their failure to love the Lord, to love their neighbors, to follow the Lord's commands about how to live together as God's people, eventually led to their downfall. And the people of Jerusalem went into exile in Babylon. They experienced adversity, death, destruction, and curses. They were put to shame. The final curse, as predicted by Deuteronomy chapter 30, was exile. And as far as the people of Israel were concerned, they were still in exile, living under the domination of the Roman Empire in Jesus' day. St. Paul gives us a summary of this history, a brief summary, in Romans chapter 9. But Paul continues then into Romans chapter 10, telling us that God raised Jesus Christ from the dead, that because of Jesus, there is no longer any distinction between Jews and Greeks, between Jewish people and the rest of the world as they thought of it, and that everyone, that's everyone who calls on the name of the Lord, shall be saved. In the incarnation, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, God fulfilled His promise. Exile is over, and faith in Jesus, because of Jesus' faithfulness to go to the cross for us, is available to everyone. Paul's experience of meeting the risen Lord on the road to Damascus, being blinded in a flash of light, then regaining his sight after a Christ follower named Ananias came to minister to him, convinced Paul that Jesus was the Messiah, the Christ. So Paul, the Old Testament scholar that he was, reinterpreted the Hebrew Scriptures through a lens that understood Jesus to be the Messiah, the one sent by God to save God's people. As Paul understood the story, based on his new understanding of Jesus, God made promises to Abraham, promises about a family that would be blessed to be a blessing, and who would be justified, made right with God on the basis of faith, rather than by following the law. In fact, those who were under the law would be cursed because pride and selfishness, going all the way back to Adam, would interfere with the ability to keep the law, to follow the commandments, to love and serve the Lord. You got to serve somebody. And it might seem like a no-brainer to serve the Lord. But we don't always do it. And because of that failure, the curse would eventually drive the people of Israel into exile. But because of the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus, life and blessings are now available to everyone. Jesus has redeemed us all. We couldn't follow the law. We couldn't keep the commandments perfectly. We couldn't truly love God and love one another. So Jesus became the curse for us by being hanged on a tree. But the curse came to an end when he rose. And Jesus overcame the power of sin, making it possible for us to live a new life, a risen life in him when he rose from the tomb. We will never follow the law perfectly, keep all of the commandments perfectly, love the Lord and our neighbors as well as God intended. We will always fall short of the glory of God. But we can be justified, made right with God, saved by confessing our failures and putting our faith in Jesus Christ, whose death and resurrection saves us from everything that separates us from God and from each other. Now, I know that in our online services, we don't usually say confession, but I'd like us to continue now with the order for confession and forgiveness. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Most merciful God, we confess that we are in bondage to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Almighty God in his mercy has given his Son to die for us and for his sake, forgives us all of our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the forgiveness of all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Now we'll continue with our love moment.
Y'all, I wanted to tell you about Messiah's kickoff parties. You're all invited to get back in the saddle on Saturday, September 10th from 4:30 to 7. And guess what? The event is free. And these horses right here wanted to say hi and let you know that their pony friends will be at the event giving pony rides to all the kids. Plus, we'll have yummy food like hot dogs, cornbread, sides, and desserts. And on top of that, there's going to be bounce houses, country music, and more. So grab your boots, grab your cowboy hat, and come out and join us. And who knows, maybe you'll even want to dance.
Cowboy, take me away. Life is through this
time. And I almost forgot to tell you, we're having a good old-fashioned chili cook-off. Wouldn't you like to taste some delicious chili and help pick the winner that will be on this year's amazing trophy? So bring your blanket, grab a lawn chair to enjoy the country concert, and tell all your friends about your Belinda's biggest shindig this year's side of town. And we're gonna have two special guests. Pastor Bob and Jeannie will be back from their summer adventures. Bye, y'all. See you on September 10th.
Cowboy, take me away. Fly this girl as high as you can.
Thanks, Libby. We're looking forward to that day as we welcome back Pastor Bob and Jeannie and we get back together for our fall kickoff. Thanks for reminding us about that. You know, in the book of Philemon, Paul writes, I am praying that you will put into action the generosity that comes from your faith as you understand and experience all the good things we have in Christ. The New Testament calls us to live generously, giving back from what God provides us for the good of God's kingdom and our neighbors in need. Your support of Messiah helps to support many ministries that help us live out the values of the kingdom of God and helps us live out our mission statement of love God, love one another. As always, you can support our ministry by making a gift to Messiah in a whole variety of ways, including giving online through your online banking or our website or our app, by texting Messiah YL to the number on the screen, or even, as I sometimes still do, writing a check. Thanks for your continued generosity and for making a difference as we seek to change lives for the sake of Jesus Christ. Now please join me in prayer. Almighty God, your Son Jesus Christ, dignified our labor by sharing our toil. On this Labor Day weekend, guide us to seek justice in the workplace, to never value things over people, and to never surrender love for gain or humility for power. Teach us to conduct business in ways that harm none and serve the common good of all your people. Your Son called on you to forgive his enemies while he was suffering shame and death for the sake of our redemption. Help us to love our enemies and to see those with whom we disagree not as our enemies, but as people created and loved by you. Deliver us from hatred, cruelty, and revenge, and enable us all someday to stand reconciled before you. We pray in the name of Jesus Christ, our risen Lord. Amen. Now, gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let's join in the prayer that our Lord taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Now let's sing our sending song.
Around us, I
We shout it out. We're alive because you're alive. And what a love we found. Death can't hold us down. We shout it out. We're alive because you're alive. And what a love we found. Death can't hold us down. We shout it out. We're alive because you're alive.
Receive the benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine upon you with grace and with mercy. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Go in peace. Serve the Lord with joy. Thanks be to God.